Turn, please, to Colossians chapter 1. And, of course, you well know that the theme for the week is centered on verse 10 and the issue of being fruitful. And I'll pick it up at verse 10, but I'm going to read on down through verse 13. Obviously, my title for the evening lesson is Let There Be Light. So I'll begin reading here Colossians chapter 1, verse 10, that ye might walk worthy of the Lord, unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power, unto all patience and longsuffering with joyfulness, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness, and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. Father, we do thank you once again for your grace. We thank you for the gift of eternal life, possible only because you placed your Son there on the altar of Calvary, where he shed his blood willingly to accomplish your eternal purpose. We thank you that we can come together as family and certainly come to your word with humble hearts and a desire to know you in a far richer and deeper way. And Father, as we examine some of these issues here regarding darkness and light, may we certainly be touched in a very deep way. And may we look at things perhaps a little bit differently. And of course, we ask all these things in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen. Now, you might be wondering why my title, Let There Be Light, might have any kind of correlation with the theme, which has to do with being fruitful. Keep your finger here. Just go to the left to Ephesians chapter 5. I doubt we're going to end up here, but ultimately, we will discover that light and darkness does have a correlation with being fruitful or being unfruitful. Notice what the Apostle Paul writes here in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 8. For ye were sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth, proving what is acceptable unto the Lord, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. If we keep reading, for it is a shame even to speak of those things which are done of them in secret, but all things that are reproved are made manifest by the light, for whatsoever doth make manifest is light. So, turning back to Colossians chapter 1, just be aware that there is a correlation between the issue of light specifically and being fruitful as opposed to darkness and being unfruitful. So, with all of that said, what I thought we would do is just sort of look at this issue of being delivered from the power of darkness. And of course, the verse previous, verse 12, talks about how it is we are partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. There are a number of passages in Paul's epistles. There are six specific passages in Paul's epistles where Paul makes this contrast between darkness and light. And something we want to point out is that in every occurrence, Paul is focusing in on a spiritual or representative type of issue. In other words, when Paul is talking about light or he's talking about darkness, he isn't necessarily referring to physical darkness or physical visible light, but as you study those occurrences, you discovered it truly is a spiritual or metaphorical type of darkness or light. So what we'll do this evening is I've broken down the lesson into three parts. I will not have a poem, but we will have three parts. We're going to look at the history of darkness and light. Then we're going to look at the mystery of darkness and light. And then we're going to look at the victory of light over darkness. I thought that's a pretty cute three-point outline, right? I mean, the history, the mystery, and the victory. There certainly is some doctrinal, historic information regarding darkness and light. there are some dispensational issues regarding darkness and light. And then ultimately, there are, of course, devotional issues regarding darkness and light. And we talk about devotional, I'm talking about the practical outworking of light or the practical application of light. So let's start things off, and we'll look at the history of darkness. Notice there in verse 13, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness. Now, darkness in the Bible can mean many different things. It can represent judgment. It can represent rebellion. It can represent death. It can represent hopelessness. It can represent calamity. It can represent evil, chaos, disorder, wickedness, danger. It can represent blindness, and it can represent ignorance. What we do know is that darkness is not a place you want to be in. God never intended his creation to be in or to experience darkness. So that's going to have to be something we need to sort of define off the bat. Simply put, obviously, darkness is the absence of light. And in the Bible, God is light. 1 John chapter 5, or 1 John chapter 1, verse 5. So what we will discover is that the absence of light is a representation of the absence of God. If you don't have light, you have darkness. If you don't have God, you have night. You have darkness. Darkness is anything outside and apart from or opposed to what God is doing. Anything at variance with his plan, his purpose, his will. Anything at odds with the system of divine revelation he may have given, wisdom and knowledge. Anything opposed is darkness. Now, granted, there are times where darkness can be used not in a destructive way. For example, when God met with Moses, you know what God did? He hid behind darkness. And he did that as an act of mercy. God is light, and no man can approach unto God, no mortal man. So God, when communing with Moses, all Israel saw was a barrier. God literally hid his divine presence, that illuminating glory, from being visibly seen by setting up a barrier of darkness. But all in all, we find that darkness is not a good thing. But notice in verse 13, who has delivered us from the power of darkness. I want to kind of focus on that for just a minute. When we think about power, the verse isn't talking about an influence or some sort of spiritual pressure or some sort of an effect or some sort of unseen force that might be working in the life of a believer. When Paul here writes about the power of darkness, we certainly can appreciate the context in which he's writing about power. He's talking about jurisdiction. He's talking about a domain. And we'll examine some things. We have been delivered from this legalistic, or I should say, this legal, authoritative jurisdiction called darkness. Think about power. A couple of verses just to highlight the point. By the way, in a few verses, if we keep reading, look there, for example, verse 16. For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or what? Powers. So in the context, we learn about this vast, highly sophisticated, organized, cosmic, geopolitical structure there are powers. Go over to Ephesians chapter 6. I know many of you are familiar, of course. Notice what Paul writes here in Ephesians chapter 6. Notice there at verse 12. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world. Rulers. These are high-ranking spiritual entities. So when you think about power, in fact, one more verse in this regard, Luke chapter 4. And this is a startling, it's really a chilling passage, and you're familiar with the temptation of our Lord Jesus Christ as he presents himself as Israel's Messiah and so forth. But anyway, just notice here in Luke chapter 4, notice verse 6. And the devil said unto him, well, let's read verse 5. Verse 5, and the devil, taking him up into a high mountain, showed unto him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. This was no ordinary mountain. And it's pretty obvious. All the kingdoms of the world. Verse 6, and the devil said unto him, all this what? Power. I will give you legal jurisdiction and governmental authority. That's the power, the domain that, in this case, the devil is offering the Lord Jesus Christ. All this power will I give thee, and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me, and to whomsoever I will, I give it. So, the power of darkness. I'm going to use the term geopolitical often tonight. By definition, the word geopolitical, I looked it up, it's a combination of geographic, political factors relating to or influencing a nation or region. So think about that. When we identify this domain, this jurisdiction of darkness, it involves two issues. One, governmental control, governmental authority. But it also includes a territory or a region, some geographic location over which political rule is going to be exercised. So please understand, in the cosmos, if I can use that terminology, there are issues of geopolitical control and activity. The first time we're introduced to this darkness, Genesis chapter 1, in honor of Brother Morris Chestnut, who, as you know, isn't able to travel. We're going to look there at Genesis, although I know Richard, he referred to the book of Genesis last night. But we'll go here to the book of Genesis, right? As Brother Morris would always say, everything begins, obviously, in the book of Genesis. And here we're introduced with the issue of darkness, right? Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and the evening and the morning were the first day. Now, I have good friends. They don't believe there is a gap between verse 1 and 2. And it's kind of irrelevant for what we're going to be doing this evening. But what we can recognize, whether you believe there's a gap, I do believe there's a gap between verses 1 and 2. But if you don't believe in the gap, we can at least recognize that there's this issue of darkness associated with something happening with the earth. So there is this darkness, and think about the language Paul is using, this power, this jurisdiction connected to the issue of the earth. At minimum, if you don't believe in the gap, we know that darkness is connected to a formless, void, empty, shapeless, barren wasteland, uninhabitable. In fact, Job chapter 10, verse 22, don't turn there. You know how Job describes darkness? He says there's no order. There's no order. So at minimum, what God is doing here is He is exposing some things that are happening in light of creation. Now, I believe there is a gap, all right? And so what I would say about verse 2 is that there is ruin. There is chaos. I'm going to coin a word. There is an uncreation taking place. There is this reversal of some things that God sought to do. There is this disorder. In fact, things are being undone. And with that said, creation begins with the earth requiring to be formed and being shaped and being filled and being illuminated. I mean, that's pretty obvious here in this passage. It begins with darkness and then it gives way to light. And interesting verse 4 or verse 5, and God called the light day. And the darkness He called night. Now, I'm not saying there wasn't some sort of physical light. God now re-entering into His creation. And yes, there is the issue of physical light. But what this darkness and light is going to represent is the issue of these two competing realms, these two territorial powers, if you will, that are going to contend. There is a clash between light and darkness. There is going to be this constant conflict throughout the Word of God until it concludes at the very end in the book of Revelation, and there will be nothing but light eventually, ultimately. So just sort of keep in mind what God is doing here is He's differentiating Himself and what it is He's doing. By the way, day, that represents a new beginning. That represents a new purpose. He ultimately is going to create a new creature. It's called Adam, a new man, an earthly man made out of the dust of the earth. We understand that. So that title, that name, day, it's representative of all that God is seeking to do, ultimately seeking restoration, seeking redemption, seeking a renewal. I love what Richard said last night. He used the word repurpose. And that's the way I would understand what's happening. But at minimum, wait a minute, there is this issue of darkness. Let's go through history. We're going to look at the history, darkness and light. Go to Genesis chapter 15. And we run into another passage that's going to highlight darkness. And this is an unusual darkness. It's a strange darkness. In fact, what makes this so strange is that as Jehovah God reaffirms a covenant that He's going to make with Abraham, and you're familiar with the Abrahamic covenant, listen, I'm going to give you a seed, I'm going to give you a people, I'm going to give you a land, I'm going to give you, there's going to be a people, there's going to be a landmass, there's going to be ultimately a kingdom by which and through which all of the families of the earth are going to be blessed. So as God now reaffirms this covenant with Abraham, notice there in Genesis chapter 15, and reading there at verse 12. And when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram. And lo, an horror of great darkness fell upon him. What a bizarre way to say, I'm going to make you a promise, Abraham. And then in the course of, you know, Abraham says, well, you know, what are you going to do? Verse 8, this is Abraham. Lord God, whereby shall I know that I shall inherit it? I mean, you know, you think that, wow, well, okay, I'll just show you this wonderful light show of how, He says, you know, I'm going to have to demonstrate to you, Abraham, your seed line, your people, my people, the nation of Israel, ultimately, they're going to have to experience suffering. They're going to have to experience death. By the way, what does sleep represent in Scripture? Deep sleep, Abraham. And not only that, my people, they're going to have to experience death, ultimately. Anyway, so verse 12. Lo, an horror of great darkness fell upon him. Verse 13, and he said unto Abraham, know of a surety that thy seed, now I want you to catch this, shall be a stranger in a land that is what? Doesn't belong to me, doesn't belong to my people. What is going to grip the land that doesn't belong to Israel? It's called darkness. It's a horror of great darkness. So we read again verse 13, and he said unto Abraham, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs. Again, I use that word geopolitical. You have this issue of governmental authority, governmental power. You have this jurisdiction, and it involves land. The land, by the way, that God specifically designated and earmarked for Abraham and for his posterity, right? We keep reading verse 13, and shall in the land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. Now, you know exactly what's going to happen. This is a reference, obviously, to Israel being in oppressive bondage there in Egypt. Verse 14, and also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterward shall they come out with great substance. So let's just recognize what's happening here. There is a landmass, any landmass that doesn't belong to me falls under this category of great darkness. And by way of some miracles that are going to happen, so on and so forth, why would this territory, if you will, why would Israel, as a stranger, why are they in the foreign nation's land going to have to fall under the horror of great darkness? We got to understand some things have happened, obviously, before Genesis chapter 15. And what we certainly know happened, go to Genesis chapter 10 real quick. Go to Genesis chapter 10. When we go to Genesis chapter 10, we have a problem after 2,000 years of human history. Let's read chapter 11. Chapter 11 really does take you back to chapter 10. If you want to understand what's going on in chapter 11, you read chapter 10, but you remember what happened there in chapter 11, all right? Let's just go to chapter 11, and the whole earth was of one language and one speech, right? And verse 3, and they said one to another, go to, let us make brick and burn them throughly. And they had brick for stone, and slime had they for mortar. And they said, go to, let us build us a city and a tower whose top may reach unto heaven, and let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth. Please be mindful, 2,000 years since Adam, okay? God's been patient. And by the way, he told Adam, you know, I want you to go out there, multiply, be fruitful, replenish the earth, so on and so forth. Remember Genesis chapter 6, sons of God, so forth, the flood, Noah. God told Noah, I want you to go out there. I want you to multiply. I want you to replenish. I want you to have dominion. I want you to be fruitful, so on and so forth, right? After 2,000 years, what is humanity seeking to do? They're seeking, as we, of course, read in verse 4, they build a tower. Now, verse 5, and the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of men builded. And the Lord said, behold, the people is one. and they have all one language. And this they begin to do, and now nothing will be restrained from them, which they have imagined to do. Go to, let us go down, and there confound their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. Now, God is not some glorified building inspector. I mean, I don't care what the shape of the building, the ziggurat, the pyramid, the size, and all that. The problem with this structure has a wicked spiritual objective. And that objective is, as described, they want to reach, verse 4, unto heaven, whose top may reach unto heaven. King David says, Jehovah God, you are my high tower. So over again in the scriptures, it's pretty obvious. This tower, you know, God doesn't care if it's the Willis Tower, if it doesn't care if it's the Statue of Liberty, he doesn't care if it's the Empire State Building. The issue is, what's going on with this structure? So with that, chapter 10, we have this list of nations in chapter 10, okay? We have this, sometimes you'll hear people call it a table of nations, correct? Just remember this, this table of nations. It happens in chapter 11. God is done. In fact, you know how Paul provides commentary, right? A subsequent narrative on what's going on in Genesis 11. What does God write in Romans chapter 1? God says, listen, you want to serve the creature more than the creator? Then I'm going to let you serve the creature more than the creator. And God said, I gave them up, I gave them over, I gave them unto. You don't want to accept me, you don't want me to be your God, then God does something. Go over to Deuteronomy chapter 4. Deuteronomy chapter 4. And be a little patient, and we'll, I trust, recognize this issue of darkness that is out there on the earth. Deuteronomy chapter 4. And let's read there at verse 19. Deuteronomy chapter 4, notice there at verse 19. And of course, here's the Lord through Moses giving the law and so forth. Verse 19, and lest thou lift up thine eyes unto heaven, and when thou seest the sun and the moon and the stars, even all the host of heaven, shouldst be driven to worship them and serve them, which the Lord thy God hath divided unto all nations under the whole heaven. So if you think about God divided the nations, you count the nations back in Genesis chapter 10, there are 70 of them, all right? But here's the point. God, when referring to the host of heaven has something to do with this division of the nations under the whole heaven. Verse 20, but the Lord hath taken you, who's that? Israel, and brought you forth out of the iron furnace, even out of Egypt, to be unto me, unto him, a people of inheritance, as ye are this day. Go down, drop down to verse 27, and the Lord shall scatter you among the nations, and ye shall be left few in number among the heathen, whither the Lord shall lead you, and there ye shall serve gods, the work of men's hands, wood and stone, which neither see, nor hear, nor eat, nor smell. Well, now, hold on for just a second. First, God appreciates something. The issue of these gods in verse 28. Now, there are physical, visible representations of these gods. Go over to Deuteronomy chapter 32. By the way, go to chapter 10 on your way to chapter 32. Notice in Deuteronomy chapter 10 and verse 17. Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 17. For the Lord your God is what? God of gods. That's kind of an interesting title. Are there other gods? Well, according to that verse, yeah, there are other gods. And certainly there's a warning that's being issued. Listen, don't you fabricate or manufacture these mementos or these replicas or these souvenirs that are aids to worship, where these small g gods will make contact, where there is this channel, if you will, between the visible physical realm and the invisible spiritual realm. Go over to Deuteronomy chapter 32, and notice again what God said he did, Deuteronomy chapter 32, and let's read verse 7. Remember the days of old, consider the years of many generations. Ask thy father and he will show thee, thy elders and they will tell thee, when the Most High divided to the nations their inheritance. Okay? But how many nations are listed in Genesis chapter 10? I already told you. How many? Seven. Okay? So what did God do at the Tower of Babel? In his righteous outrage, I gave humanity 2,000 years. You don't want me. This is what I'm going to do. I'm going to give up on you, and I'm going to let the nations have their inheritance. Now, in verse 8, when the Most High divided to the nations their inheritance, when he separated the sons of Adam, he set the bounds of the people according to the number of the children of Israel. By the way, interesting, back there, Genesis 10, Israel's not in the table of nations. That's telling you there's something really weird going on here, okay? Israel's not even there in Genesis chapter 10, okay? But verse 9, for the Lord's portion is his people, Jacob is the lot of his inheritance. So just envision what God's done. Okay, the world doesn't want me. I'm going to give them up. I'm going to give the nations to the hosts of heaven. But Israel belongs to who? God. They are my inheritance, as the Lord said. Look at verse 12. So the Lord alone did lead him, and there was no strange God with him. Drop down to verse 16. They provoked him to jealousy. With strange gods, with abominations, provoked they him to anger. They sacrificed unto what? Listen, gods are, when the Bible's talking about gods, according to verse 17, they're devils. They're real entities. They're fallen creatures. They're part of the power of darkness. This darkness that covers and blankets the world, the earth, it is their jurisdiction. These gods, these devils, they have legal authoritative right over the nations because God said, I'm going to give the nations to these entities because they don't want me. You know, God is a bit of a gentleman. You don't want me, then you get what you want. You want to worship these guys? You want to build a tower and make contact with them? Tell you what, I'm going to let them be your gods. And again, just note verse 17, they sacrificed them to devils, not to God, to gods whom they knew not, to whom gods that came newly up, whom your fathers feared not. Drop down to verse 37, and he shall say, where are their gods, their rock in whom they trusted, which did eat the fat of their sacrifices and drank the wine of their drink offerings? Let them rise up and help you and be your protection. Wow, the Lord's being, you know, look at verse 41, if I wet my glittering sword and mine hand take hold of judgment, I will render vengeance to mine enemies and reward them that hate me. Go over to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and then Psalms chapter 106. What I'd like to just press is the point that when God gave up on these nations, he didn't just abandon them. He did. He disinherited them. God disowned the nations. The nations persisted. We're not going to worship you. And God created humanity with the capacity to worship. Humanity needs to worship something, whether it's themselves or the true God or the small g gods. God says, all right, I disinherit, I disown the nations. Those small g gods, where are you at? I don't know what I said. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, right? Just 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And by the way, the Apostle Paul, I mean, anyway, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, notice what Paul writes there at verse 19. What shall I say then? That the idol is anything? Or that which is offered in sacrifice to idols is anything? But I say that the things with the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to who? Are these real entities? Remember what Jesus was doing, casting them out. And we'll go to that in just a moment here. Verse 20, they sacrifice to devils and not to God. I would not that ye should have fellowship with who? Devils. Verse 21, you cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of devils. You cannot be partakers of the Lord's table and of the table of devils. Psalms 106. And notice here, Psalms 106, verse 34. They did not destroy the nations. Oh, you know, have you ever heard someone criticize the Word of God saying, what kind of a cruel, vile God would command a nation to kill women and babies? You know, when God sent Israel out there. You know what people don't understand? These nations, they were under the jurisdiction of darkness. They were part of this geopolitical system, this spiritual geopolitical system. God had a reason to eradicate these nations because of the spiritual activity that's taking place. Verse 34, they did not destroy the nations concerning whom the Lord commanded them, but were mingled among the heathen and learned their works, and they served their idols, which were a snare unto them. Yea, they sacrificed their sons and their daughters unto who? So, okay, you have a dumb, ignorant, Canaanite, parasite, Hittite, and they're worshiping some stone, some branch, some rock, and they're led to sacrifice their own sons and daughters. Visibly, it's like, man, what a bunch of dope heads spiritually. There are some powers back there. The verse says, they sacrificed their sons and their daughters unto devils. Verse 38, and shed innocent blood, even the blood of their sons and their daughters, whom they sacrificed unto the idols of Canaan. And the land was polluted with blood. Wow. Keep that in mind. Now, let's go quickly to Exodus chapter 10. Okay, now we're going to, so I just gave a kind of a brief little history. When God establishes again that covenant with Abraham, and he affirms it, and you have this horror of great darkness, but it has to do with Israel not being in her land. What's the problem? Well, Israel's land's supposed to be the land of light. The land or territory or region where Jehovah is worshiped, where Jehovah is implementing his purpose and plan and strategies. And you see the outworking of all of these activities. But when Israel is not in her land, she's in somebody else's land, it's horror of great darkness. There's a problem out there. Exodus chapter 10. Go to Exodus chapter 10. And this is the last of a series of plagues. You know, there's 10 plagues, but anyway, you can break the first 9 into 3 sections. Anyway, there's 3 series of 3, but notice Exodus chapter 10, verse 21. And the Lord said unto Moses, stretch out thine hand toward heaven, that there may be darkness over the land of Egypt, even darkness which may be felt. There's something spiritual going on. And Moses stretched forth his hand toward heaven, and there was a thick darkness in all the land of Egypt 3 days. That's the furnace of iron. Does Israel belong there in the land of Egypt? No. But they're in or under the jurisdiction of darkness. Verse 23, they saw not one another, neither rose any from his place for 3 days. But all the children of Israel had light in their dwellings. Okay? You know, you have these gods in Egypt, these devils that are exercising geopolitical control in this landmass, this area, this region. They're not going to let God get away with this nation, Israel. By the way, what did God do or intend to do with Israel? Exodus chapter 1, if you allow me to read that verse very quickly. Exodus chapter 1, verse 7. And the children of Israel were fruitful and increased abundantly and multiplied and waxed exceeding mighty. And the land was what? Filled with them. What do you think these gods, these devils are going to do? The power of darkness, they're not going to let this happen. So what do? They have them in captivity. They have them in bondage. They're enslaved. And God, by a miraculous event, he says, all right, I'm going to show you something. You see that territory out there? It's a darkness that is felt. It's a spiritual darkness. It's an ugly darkness. This is what God is doing. Go to Exodus chapter 12. Exodus chapter 12. And throughout this whole account in the deliverance, Exodus chapter 12, verse 12, for I will pass through the land of Egypt this night and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both men and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. Lord of lords, God of gods. These gods want to challenge the Lord. The Lord says, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'll fight you guys. You want to fight me? So you have this imagery. You have this representation of darkness. Now go to Matthew chapter 4. Go to Matthew chapter 4. The land. Israel's not in her land. She's in Gentile territory. And God, by way of a plague, he's communicating to all of these geopolitical powers and structures. He's saying, listen, my people, they're still the light. Even though you're trying to challenge what I'm trying to do, Matthew chapter 4, here's another account of this light and darkness. Matthew chapter 4, look there at verse 15. The land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea, beyond Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. Now, Galilee of the Gentiles. At this point in history, Israel is all over the map, if I can say it that way, all right? Israel, they're occupying territory which belongs to the Gentiles. Now, is that where God intended Israel to be? That isn't where God intended Israel to be. So as a consequence, Israel's out there in these territories, in these regions, as named there at verse 15. It's called Galilee of the Gentiles. And you know what Israel did historically? They began to adopt the various practices that these pagan, idol-worshipping, devil-worshipping, small g gods are engaged in. They adopted the economic systems, the culture, the political systems. They began to intermarry. So now you have this ethnic and racial connection to the land. Look at what we read in verse 16. The people, that's Israel, by the way. Jesus isn't talking about I'm going to the Gentiles, but rather Israel is in land occupied by the Gentiles. Shouldn't have been that way. The people which sat in what? Why? Why does the verse say, my people Israel are in dark, the jurisdiction of darkness, the very realm and region and territory that God said, I gave them to the Gentiles. My people are my inheritance, Israel, and they're not going to be a part of that entire structure. But sadly, you find Israel in the very region she shouldn't have been. Verse 16, the people which sat in darkness saw great light, and to them which sat in the region. You see the geopolitical connotation here? darkness, there's a region, there's power. Them which sat in the region and shadow of death, light is sprung up. One of the first things Jesus is doing is he's going into this foreign territory and he's going to face these gods. Drop down to verse 24. And his fame went throughout all Syria, and they brought unto him all sick people that were taken with diverse diseases and torments, and those which were possessed with what?
Devils.
People scratch, what's going on with all of these, all this devil activity? We read Psalms chapter 106. The land is what? Polluted. It's occupied by these entities. They are, as the verse, they are devils. And that's a problem. Go to Mark chapter 5. Mark chapter 5. In fact, you begin to examine this activity and you talk about this darkness. Mark chapter 5. And notice in Mark chapter 5, verse 9. And he asked him, "What is thy name?" And he answered, saying, "My name is Legion, for we are many." And he besought him much that he would not send them away out of the what? Verse 12, and all the devils, I don't know, 2,000, whatever, all the devils besought him, saying, "Send us into the swine, that we may enter into them." So wait a minute, you got this occupation of devils in the entire region. What's the light doing? The light sprung up. He's evicting these entities. He's getting these people. He's getting these gods out of there. Listen, I'm rescuing my people from the region and the shadow of darkness. These entities, they're out there exercising authority and jurisdiction over his people. Go to Luke chapter 22. Luke chapter 22. Just wait a minute. And we're going to tie it all together, I hope. The issue of this area, this regional, this geographic, Luke chapter 22. And here, the Lord Jesus Christ, Luke chapter 22, verse 53. When I was daily with you in the temple, ye stretched forth no hands against me, but this is your hour, apostate Israel, and the power of what? Now, what did we read in Colossians chapter 1, verse 13? We now know we've been delivered from the power of darkness. You see, apostate Israel, you know what's going on? They're now under the jurisdiction of the power of darkness. Chapter 23, Luke chapter 23. Okay, anyway, chapter 23, notice there, verse 44. Luke chapter 23, verse 44. Here's the Lord Jesus Christ. He's on the cross already. And it was about the sixth hour, and there was a darkness over all the earth until the ninth hour. And the sun was darkened, and the veil of the temple was rent in the midst. You know what we read? Now, this verse 44 says that darkness was over all the earth until the ninth hour. This is the hour, your hour. This is the hour of the power of darkness. You know what's going on? Israel has become a spiritual Egypt. What's happening is there is an undoing. There is an uncreation taking place on the cross of Calvary. Go over to Mark chapter 15. And just notice how Mark and Matthew also reads this way in Mark chapter 15. Mark chapter 15, we read there at verse 33. Mark chapter 15 and verse 33. And when the sixth hour was come, there was darkness over the whole what? Land. Now Luke said over the earth. Verse 33, what land is God always consumed with in the Word of God? Bingo. My land. what? So if you want to say the entire earth, I believe it's the case. But anyway, the point is this. Mark and Matthew, they say there was this three-hour supernatural darkness from 12 noon till 3 in the afternoon, blotted out the sun, blotted out any source of celestial illumination. This is no ordinary darkness. It's the power of darkness. Satan had legal jurisdiction. Jesus was handed over by the apostate nation of Israel that are functioning as a bunch of pagan Egyptians, spiritual Egyptians, operating under the jurisdiction of these gods and of these devils. So what you witness on the cross of Calvary is God leaving. By the way, if darkness is the absence of light, God is light. Darkness is the absence of Almighty God. And just as creation begins, you know, with the earth requiring forming and shaping and filling and illumination, well, you know what happens when the lights go out? When now creation is plunged back into darkness, things are going backwards, things are in reverse, things are being undone. There is an uncreation taking place on the cross of Calvary. You know what the order should have been? Israel faithfully believing Messiah, receiving the kingdom, being the light to the whole world, Isaiah chapter 60, 61. What did they do? They crucified their king. God's withdrawn. God, he's abandoned. And Jesus, he's left alone on that cross. The world is undone. And instead of the calm voice of God in Genesis 1 saying, "Let there be light," you know what Jesus ultimately has to start crying? My God, why hast thou forsaken me?" God's out of there. Darkness. 3 hours. Israel, your land is just like the Gentiles. You're nothing but perverse, apostate Egyptians. Sad testimony. At the cross, what you're witnessing is the chaos, the ruin, the formlessness, the barren wasteland of the nation of Israel. And it's demonstrated by this darkness that falls upon the cross of Calvary. Now, we know something about what took place there. Tell you what, let's go to the mystery. Let's go quickly. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. So historically, we can trace the roots of darkness and light, and we see, wait, there is a clear correlation between this demonic activity, this devil activity, the false god worship, and the territory in which they're operating in. And the whole world was given to these creatures, these entities. Israel was God's inheritance. Nobody dares touch Israel, but Israel, they willingly participated and joined the power of darkness ultimately, resulting in the crucifixion. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Now, quickly, the mystery of light and darkness. We read there in 2 Corinthians chapter 6. Chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6. Okay, chapter 4, verse 6. "For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness." Now, what do you think of when you read verse 6? I mean, right away, Paul, by the way, there's a number of times that Paul provides further detail, further narrative on the creation event in Genesis chapter 1. He does it in Colossians, he does it in Ephesians, so on and so forth. My point is this. When you read about God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, doesn't that take you back to Genesis chapter 1? Hey, day, night, light, dark. Back there in Genesis 1, there's a new beginning. There's a new purpose. There's a new dawn. There's a creature named Adam that I'm creating. Paul, he is singled out. Now notice in verse 6, "For God who commanded the light to shine out of the darkness hath shined in our hearts." Now, technically, Paul is talking about his apostleship. If you go, just look there at chapter 3. Look at chapter 3, verse 1. "Do we begin again to commend our selves. Verse 2, ye are our epistle written in our hearts. In other words, when Paul talks about the light shining in our hearts, in fact, go to chapter 1, look there at verse 19, chapter 1, verse 19. For the Son of God, Jesus Christ, was preached among you by us, even by me and Silvanus and Timotheus. So what Paul is referring to in chapter 4, verse 6, God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness has shined in our hearts. Paul and his co-laborers, there is a very important dispensational event that's taking place here. Just as God reveals his creative purpose there in Genesis chapter 1, God is now going to reveal a new creative purpose. And he's doing what he did back there in Genesis 1. The language of redemption, the language of restoration, the language of reclamation. So what Paul is saying is, you know what God's doing with me? Go to Acts chapter 13. This verse clearly associates this issue of this light shining out of darkness, which was in Paul's heart, part of Paul's message, part of Paul's ministry. Look there at Acts chapter 13 and verse 46, Acts chapter 13, verse 46. Then Paul and Barnabas waxed bold and said, it was necessary that the word of God should first have been spoken to you, but seeing ye put it from you and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, lo, we turn to the Gentiles. For so hath the Lord commanded us, that's Paul and his co-laborers, right? Saying, I have set thee, Paul, to be a light of the Gentiles, that thou shouldest be for salvation unto the ends of the earth. Now, I want you to think about that for a second. Did God not disown and disinherit and abandon the Gentiles to the whole table of nations? He gave them to these powers, the darkness. And you know what God now, through the Apostle Paul, is revealing? Go back to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6. For God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, he shined in our hearts. Listen, just like Isaiah, I have been sent to be a light to who? The Gentiles. Gentiles that were historically consigned to the jurisdiction and the domain of these powers, these entities. Darkness has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. The knowledge of the glory of God, it has everything to do with this system of divine revelation. God calls it light. It reveals the details of his purpose, of his plan, his intent, his design. But he's doing it with who? Gentiles. Wait a minute. God said, I disown you. You're Satan's property. You belong to the gods. You know why when he says that as Gentiles, we were without God in the world, having how much hope? No. Zero zippo. God said, I've got nothing to do with you. The gods can have you because you want them. Now God's doing something with who? Gentile. Can you appreciate the significance of what God is doing in the dispensation of the grace of God? In fact, go back to Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1. And, you know, we're talking about Egypt here, right? Fascinating. The language that Paul is using, for example, in Colossians chapter 1, it parallels the language that we find in the book of Exodus. Let's read verse 13 again. Colossians 1, verse 13. Who hath delivered us? Now, I want you to deliver. You know, have you ever gotten yourself in a bind? And, you know, you kind of got in a little bit of trouble or a lot of trouble. And you know, given enough time, you can kind of work your way out of it or weasel your way out of it, you know. And, you know, I can... when the verse talks about deliverance, Paul's talking about a rescue. This is a deliverance that you and I can do nothing about, cannot participate in, we can't contribute to it. What Paul, by using the word deliverance, God has rescued Gentiles. Now, let's just quickly go back to Exodus, because I just want you to notice the language. When God delivered Israel from the iron furnace, when he delivered Israel from the great horror of darkness that Abraham sadly had to experience, when we read about that ninth plague, you know what? The entire land of Egypt, they're in a darkness that can be felt. But not my people, they're light. What was God doing? Exodus chapter 3. And just notice, for example, Exodus chapter 3, verse 8. Exodus 3, verse 8. And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians. What's God do? I'm going to deliver them. Now, just appreciate what Paul is saying. God, he's telling Gentiles, you know what? I'm going to reveal something. And I'm going to send Paul to be a light to you dead Gentiles. Remember, dead in trespasses and sins and the uncircumcision of our flesh. Without hope, without God. Just like God came down, delivered Israel out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land onto a good land and a large and on a land. I think you know where I'm going with this, right? You know what God is doing in the dispensation of grace? He is rescuing Gentiles, delivering Gentiles from those wicked principalities and powers and rulers of the darkness of this world. He's going to deliver Gentiles today from these satanically occupied regions, just like in parallel, God did it to Israel. I'm going to deliver you out of the land, that iron furnace, under the darkness, the power of darkness, satanic dominion. And I'm going to bring you into a land flowing with milk and honey, onto a place of the Canaanites, so on and so forth. Go over to chapter 18. Go to chapter 18 and notice here, chapter 18, verse 8. Exodus chapter 18 and verse 8. Exodus chapter 18, verse 8. And Moses told his father-in-law all that the Lord had done unto Pharaoh and to the Egyptians for Israel's sake, and all the travail that had come upon them by the way, and how the Lord delivered them. And Jethro rejoiced for all the goodness which the Lord had done to Israel, whom he had delivered out of the hand of the Egyptians. And Jethro said, blessed be the Lord who hath delivered you out of the hand of the Egyptians. This was something to celebrate. This is something that brought great joy, so great excitement. Look at verse 11. Now I know that the Lord is greater than all what? God. Who won? The true God. He said, that's my people. He went down there and I'm going to destroy all of you gods. How dare you imprison and enslave my people? I'm going to go down there, and he did. Go over to chapter 14, Exodus chapter 14. God says, I will personally intervene. I will supernaturally rescue my people from the clutches of these gods. How dare they touch my inheritance? And I love Exodus chapter 14, verse 13. Exodus 14, verse 13. And Moses said unto the people, fear not, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show you today. For the Egyptians whom ye have seen today, ye shall see them again no more. For how long? Man, think about that. Now, time is gone. Think about our message, our gospel, our deliverance, the deliverance that God is offering to an unbelieving world, historically abandoned by God, having no hope. God said, you know what I'll do for you? I'll rescue you. and I'll rescue you from the wickedness occupying those places. And you know, when I rescue you, you're never going to see them again. Look at verse 14. The Lord shall fight for you, and ye shall hold your peace. And beautiful. So we got to stop. Let's go back to Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2. I think the chart is trying to attack me here. Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2. And we're going to finish here. Let's go to Colossians chapter 2. Off the wall. He's off the wall. Is that what you said? Colossians chapter 2. And let's go to Luke chapter 11. Colossians chapter 2. And then let's go to Luke chapter 11. And when we trust the Lord Jesus Christ, by the way, when Paul says, you know, the light of the glory of the knowledge of God in the face of who? Jesus Christ. The face that was spat upon, the face that was slapped, the face that was punched, the face that was beaten, the face that was marred, the face that had the blood trickling from the crown of thorns that plucked the brow of our dear Savior, who was it earlier? Marred more than any man. Nobody's going to touch his face again. It's that same man who gave his face to be abused and battered and tortured. Well, that face, there's a lot going on there in the face of Jesus Christ. He's coming back. In Colossians chapter 2, Colossians chapter 2, verse 15, and having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. Now think about what was spoiled. What did God do? God has a message today that is such, and by the way, this is God's personal, private assault in the heavenly places. You're familiar with D-Day, right? Tom, you were there, right? I'm kidding. You know, June 6th, 1944, right? D-Day, right? I mean, the greatest, largest land invasion in all of human history, right? And many military analysts, historians, they would say, you know what? The war was won on the beaches of Normandy. Now, technically, the war went on for almost another year. But, again, the war, even military, German military high command, they knew the war is over. The Allies, they've just stormed the beaches of Normandy. Who's going to stop it? My point is this. You know, when you think about what God did, when he spoiled principalities and powers, what exactly was spoiled? Go to Luke chapter 11. Luke chapter 11. And here's a good passage. Luke chapter 11. And you remember how the Lord, he's being accused of casting out devils in the name of Beelzebub, so on and so forth, right? And so the Lord, of course, he basically shows them the stupidity of their argument. But anyway, verse 21, when a strong man armed keepeth his palace, his goods are in peace. That strong man is Satan. But when a stronger than he shall come upon him, who do you think that is? Lord Jesus Christ, and overcome him. He taketh from him all his armor wherein he trusted and divideth his spoils. What spoils is the Lord Jesus talking about? If you go over to Matthew chapter 12, Matthew chapter 12. In this case, in the Gospels, the spoils are the nation of Israel. You know what Jesus is doing. Satan has a stranglehold on the nation of Israel. So Jesus, as Messiah, who is stronger than Satan, you know what he's trying to do? He's going to disarm the adversary, but he wants to take back the nation of Israel. those are the spoils, Matthew chapter 12. And if you notice there at verse 28, but if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come unto you. Or else, how can one enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods? Well, the strong man, that's Satan. What exactly are his goods? Except he first bind the strong man, and then he will spoil his house. You see, Satan is exercising authority over the nation of Israel because of Israel's participation in the program and policy of evil. The spoils are the nation of Israel. What I'm getting at is, when we read in Colossians chapter 2, verse 15, you know what God today is putting on open display to the shame of those powers and principalities? Well, listen, he's taking back what was once the rightful jurisdiction of the power of darkness. We're the spoils. And God, in his deliverance, in his salvation, he launched a secret assault, an air campaign. The prince of the power of the air power, for those of you who understand what I'm saying. Anyway, so the mystery of light and darkness, that's part of that secret that God all along, he intended to get those heavenly places back. And he defeated the power of darkness. He's spoiling those entities. When a person trusts the Lord Jesus Christ, I'll read the verse. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 8. For ye were sometimes darkness. That was our identity. We were. It doesn't say we lived in darkness. We, you know, acted. We were sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. We're no longer Satan's property. No authority. He's been disarmed. His authority has been void and null. It's been nullified. I mean, we are now light. We're not part of that program anymore. Well, I'm going to stop. The fact that he's doing this to Gentiles, that's just unheard of. Right division is so important to God because it puts on display not only his love, but his wisdom, the excellency of the knowledge of what it is he's doing. Father, we do thank you for your grace. We do thank you for your love. We do thank you for the deliverance that you have secured through your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who went to that cross as that perfect propitiation, that sacrifice for all of our sins. We thank you, Lord, that we now, as light, can go forth and share with others this wonderful deliverance program, this wonderful rescue program that you have in operation. We thank you for in Christ's name. Amen.